Excellent. So I guess we are ready to start. I apologize for the delay linked to, looks like my laptop was grossly outdated, and it took 10 or 15 minutes for it to update all the systems. So, and I sincerely hope that it will not die on us in the middle of presentation now being fully updated. So it is my pleasure and honor to introduce our today's speaker and to moderate the discussion. Tatiana Tairova-Yakovleva is someone who is well known at the Institute. It seems to me this is your third, I'm correct, third or maybe fourth, maybe
Fourth.
fourth really visit to the Institute, certainly under new circumstances for all of us. And those circumstances are, of course, the all-out Russian aggression against Ukraine. And Professor Tairova-Yakovleva's affiliation, which through all those years, or most of those years, used to be the St. Petersburg University. And now that affiliation, it's different, as you could see from the flyer of our today's talk. So Tatiana Tairova-Yakovleva today is fellow at the Gerda Henkel Foundation in Germany, and the program, in particular her program, is also supported by the Institute. So this visit is part of that also program and part of that research, and we welcome Professor Tairova. The presentation will be based on the ongoing research on the book on biography of Ivan Bohun, one of the on the one hand, maybe best known for the general public, but also little known, I would say, for the academic circles, figure in the history of the Hetmanate. And this sounds like certainly a lot of contradiction there, how the public can know the person that scholars don't little about. Well, partially because Ivan Bohun made quite a career in literature and in fiction, and now the time had come also to research, to discuss this figure in a different context, in the academic context. And this is exactly what we are going to do today. So without further ado, I would like to offer this. Actually, we have two mics, so I'm not offering any mics. There are three mics, so I'm offering the floor to Professor Tairova-Yakovleva.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute for this fantastic opportunity to come back here to Harvard to thank Professor Plokhii. I'm really very happy to be here, and it's a great honor to make this presentation of my upcoming book, which hopefully will be published in the beginning of next year in Ukraine, in Kyiv, in Vydavnictvo Clio. The book is finished. It was done with the support of the Gerda Henkel Foundation. It was written during the war, but I was very lucky that most of the material for this book I was able to collect before war, because enormous amount of documents which I needed for this study in Moscow archive. And of course, during the war, I already collected lots of materials in archives in Poland, as well as some in Sweden. But anyway, the book is finished. And today I want to present some highlights of my study and to speak about Bohun, who is my favorite hero of the times of Hetmanate. But also, I think it's very important to try to revise our knowledge about Hetmanate in all and overall, and about our knowledge about the period of ruin, which is extremely tragic in the history of Ukraine. So Ivan Bohun is someone about whom many people know from the literature or from the movies. And since the novel of Sienkiewicz, Bohun was presented like a bandit, not very nice guy. Thanks to many people, many students know Bohun, even in Ukraine, from the Polish film Ognimi Mechem, and which tried to present him like more or less not bad guy, but anyways, he became very popular in Poland and Ukraine because of this movie. Still, there is no academic biography of Ivan Bohun ever written, and because, first of all, of the lack of our knowledge about facts of his biography, and that's why it was a great challenge for me to try to put together different parts of his biography. It's like a huge puzzle, which I was trying to put together from the little facts, little new documents which I have found. And overall, it's, to my mind, create absolutely fascinating picture of one of the major key figures of the times of Khmelnytsky, and Khmelnytsky's uprising. And also, it's very important to understand who actually were those people who were in the top of the uprising, and who were creating the Ukrainian state Hetmanate. Why they were able to do this, it was a great challenge, and who they were, what kind of education they had, what kind of background they had. And of course, Bohun was one of those who were on the top of all these events. So let's start from the beginning. Now we can tell for sure that Ivan Bohun was the son of the Ukrainian shlakhtich Teodor Bohun, who was a tenant in the small small town named Bubnovka, which is on the left bank of Dnipro. And you can see the map of Baplan, which presents this little village. And so, which is what is very much important, that Bohun was born and raised in Kanivska Starostvo, which was a region in which a huge percent of population were Cossacks, meaning those who were registered Cossacks and those who used to call themselves Cossacks and took part in the free life with rights and so on. So he was born in the region, which was a Cossacks region. It's also very important to understand that he was a nobleman. He was shlakhtich, and now we can say it absolutely sure, because there is a coat of arms of Bohun in his seal, in his that we have an impress of his personal seal on one of Universale, which was signed by Ivan Bohun himself. And also now there exists the personal a seal of ring seal of his brother Vasil Bohun, which has the same coat on arms, which is called bow, and this is one of the famous noble coat of arms, which belongs to many noble families in the Lithuanian great dukes Lithuanian. So his another, there are many proofs that he was noble, but one of them is that his father applied to Lublinsky Tribunal, which was the only court for noble nobility. And so only noble person could apply to this court. And so definitely the family was a noble one. It was not a very rich family, but still it was a family which behaved very would say they behaved like rich people. They could have problems with their neighbors. They could charge them in court. They could try to get some of their property. So it was a very style life of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth of the beginning of 17th century, but also it was a style life of the Cossacks. We don't know anything that his father was connected with the Cossacks, but probably his uncle was a colonel in the registered Cossacks during the uprising of 1638. So, of course, this had some kind of influence on Ivan. Ivan was born approximately in 1620 and got a nice education because we have his handwriting, which proves that he was quite well-educated man. And probably he got his education in Kyiv because the handwriting is similar to the one which students got in Kyiv Bratska Shkola. I was able to find some quite interesting documents which prove that Bohun had connections with the people from Kyiv, including monks and some representative of the church, of Orthodox Church of Kyiv, and these ties probably goes back from the times of his youth. So he was born in Kaniv Starostva, he got some education, and then he started his career. As not a rich man, he had not too many choices what to do, either the civil career, juridical like Vyhovsky did, or a military career. And Ivan, because he had absolutely fascinating talent in military, he chose the military career. So we have the first documents, and I was very lucky to find lots of documents about him in Moscow archive in this period of his life. The first document goes back to 1641, when he was already Ataman. And he was Ataman on the service of Polish king in Kodak fortress. So he was not registered Cossack, but he was on the service of king, military service, and he was already Ataman. Probably because of his nobility, because of his education, he got directly into offices. Anyway, from 1641, almost every year, for the next 5 years, he was taking part in the rides to the wild fields in between the area between Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and Moscow, Moscow. In these wild fields, he was acting very bravely. His small units in which he commanded got lots of they were very, very lucky. They beat it, Tatars. They got lots of horses and other value things. And so his name became quite popular among Cossacks who joined him in his these raids. But in 1643 appeared one big problem, started one situation has happened. For some reason, which is absolutely unclear, Bohun got a conflict with Don Cossacks and some representatives of Moscow state. There was a small battle, relatively small, but for the sizes in the of the events in the wild field, it was a big battle. In which battle Bohun killed almost 20 Moscow soldiers, including Don Cossacks. All the rest were beaten, wounded, and had to give up. And this battle has happened in between Don and Siversky Donets. The battle was for the right to use the one of the major roads where mostly Tatars went, and so it was actually the fight for between Moscow forces and I would say Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth forces, who will control these routes in the wild fields. It was very had huge importance for everybody in this particular wild field. So Bohun got a very nice first famous victory. But then happens very unpredictable things. I was able to find two documents, Tsarskiy Gramoty, in which Tsar Fyodor Mikhailovich, Mikhail Romanov insisted that Bohun will be should have a death sentence and he should be executed. Two Tsarskiy Gramoty in which Tsar himself insisted to execute Ivan Bohun. It's absolutely fascinating. And then there was almost 3 years of negotiations between Moscow state and Polish king, what to do with this episode, what to do with this battle, and what to do with Bohun. In the first stage, Polish side wanted to say that they don't know, they will try to make investigation. Probably Bohun was in certain ways supported by Hetman of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, Konietzpolski, who supported in certain sense Cossacks. Anyway, so 2 or 3 years started all these episodes. Probably Bohun himself didn't know what was happening because he was going to wild field each time when he went and Moscow authority got the information that Bohun again appears in wild field, they got crazy and sent a new note to Polish king to execute him finally. But finally, in 1646, when in Polish authorities has changed the policy against Cossacks, Koniec Polski has died, and Polish magnates, first of all, decided that they will get rid of Cossacks. This changed the whole policy of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealths. And in 1647, as we know, happens, they went with Bohdan Khmelnytsky when Chaplinsky catched him and created all these events in Subotiv. And in the same time, probably in autumn of 1647, Bohun was arrested. Vladislav IV issued a document, Gramota, in which he also gave a death sentence to Bohun. So Bohun was arrested, and my guess is that he was kept in Kodak fortress, because where he served, and it's very looks that it's most possible that he was kept in Kodak fortress. He was not executed immediately, of course, because he was a nobleman, and according to the law of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, there should be an investigation. But an investigation didn't start because the Khmelnytsky uprising had started. And so, because now we know that there was a death sentence to Bohun, both from Moscow Tsar and Polish King, now we understand why Ivan Bohun didn't take part in the first three major battles of Khmelnytsky uprising. He didn't take part in Zhelty Vody, Korsun, and Pilava, because he was arrested and he was in Kodak fortress. But in October, on October 1st, on 1648, Kodak fortress was liberated by troops of Bohdan Khmelnytsky. And 3 weeks later, Ivan Bohun appeared near Lviv. So puzzles comes together. And from this particular time, he starts his career as colonel. He immediately became a colonel, and of course for Khmelnytsky it was a great luck that a very experienced, very young, very ambitious, and very angry against Poland man would join his forces and would become one of his major colonels. In actual, I think it's very important when we speak about conflict between particularly Bohun and Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealths. It's very similar to what has happened with Bohdan Khmelnytsky and Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealths. Ambitious, talented, orthodox Ukrainian nobility was serving Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealths, and Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth has betrayed them. And so this was the reason why they supported and started the uprising, and they were trying to first to show the king and Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth that they want to have a right in their country. And because they failed in insisting on this idea, they decided to create their own state. There are many quite interesting stories in the biography of Ivan Bohun, which tells about his relations between him and some other very famous historical figures. One, of course, is his relations with Stefan Chernetsky. It's possible, I'm not quite sure yet, but it's possible that they got acquainted in the times when Bohun served in Kodak. But definitely, his fight against Chernetsky over all years It's fascinating story. It could be written any kind of novel because Chernetsky was trying to follow him from one battle to another and always failed. And Chernetsky, of course, was a great military leader of Poland and famous hero. So anyway, their relations during many, many years and their struggle in which Bohun was always winning, it's quite one of the most fascinating stories for me. But what is much more important for understanding of the Ukrainian history, it's the relations of Bohun with Khmelnytsky and later with Ivan Vyhovsky. With Bohdan Khmelnytsky, I was able to find lots of evidences that their relations has changed. And the first step, Khmelnytsky supported Bohun a lot, made him a colonel, made him one of 16 registered colonels. And by the way, I forgot to say that because Bohun has started his career in Khmelnytsky's army, having two death sentences. That's why from the very beginning he used not his name, Ivan Bohun, but his nickname, Ivan Teodorovitch, Lefedorovich, which means name of his father. And because even in the official register of Cossacks of 1649, he could not apply as Ivan Bohun because he has a death sentence, and this death sentence was not cancelled because it was not about the Khmelnytsky uprising, but it was about another event. So that's why Bohun appeared as Ivan Fedorovich. And only later when something has happened, he finally became again Ivan Bohun. So with Bohdan Khmelnytsky, Bohun had in the beginning quite well relations. But after a fantastic victory at Vinnytsia in 1651, Khmelnytsky became very jealous to Bohun, and especially he was afraid that his influence in Bratslavshchina, where he has replaced Ivan Danilo Nechai and became the he was not only the colonel of Kalnikov Vinnytsia, but since 1651, Bohun became the major governor of the whole Bratslavshchina region. It's like Siversky Hetmane, like for example, Zolotarenko, Bohun was in certain way Bratslavsky Hetman. And Khmelnytsky became too very suspicious to Bohun that he could have a real power. And especially after when in 1654, Polish king proposed to Bohun to become Hetman, from these times, Khmelnytsky was especially suspicious. But Bohun got a fantastic friend and comrade with whom he participated a lot in the Ukrainian historical events of Hetmanate. It was Ivan Vyhovsky. I found quite interesting documents and story that it was Ivan Vyhovsky who applied to the Tsar to cancel the death sentence of Bohun. It happened in 1654 in spring, and since that time we never meet again Ivan Fedorovich and Ivan Bohun in all official documents appeared. Vyhovsky supported Bohun not just because they were friends, but also because he had some hopes to become in future Hetman. And definitely it was exactly Ivan Bohun who helped Vyhovsky to become a full Hetman in 1657. It's very interesting how he was managed to do this. During the First election, Bohun, didn't took place when Yuri Khmelnytsky was elected. And later, in the next two elections, it was particularly Bohun here who insisted on Vyhovsky as a hetman. So we now know much more about Bohun, politician, and his views, what he actually wanted to do. I think it's... We can speak a lot about his military achievements because he was a brilliant military leader. But here I'm not going to speak about this. I will just say that now we can say that Bohun took played a very important role in two major battles ruined of Khmelnytsky time and during ruin, about which we didn't know this. This is about Batoh. 1652, he was actually in the charge of leading all Cossacks. And second battle is Konotop. It's interesting, in both cases, Bohun was dealing together with Tatars, with his friend Tatarsky Aha. And so these were two brilliant victories of this union of Bohun and Tatars. But Bohun was not just a military leader of the level of Ukraine or Poland. He was also a military level, military leader of the European level, and which is extremely important for me. And I think since Mykhailo Hrushevsky, we viewed the Transylvanian campaign of Ukrainian Cossacks, something was not very successful, but actually it was very successful. They took over together with Transylvanian army, Warszawa and Krakow. And it was extreme success. And I found a very interesting letter of Ivan Vyhovsky, where he was speaking about Bohun, that he was a man who took over easily all fortresses in Poland during this campaign of 1657. So this was a huge success of the European level, because Bohun was acting together with the Swedish army. And this is a very interesting example of the union of Ukrainian Cossacks with the Swedish army, and very successful union and neutral events, what they were doing. And by the way, during this military campaign, which also for me is absolutely fascinating, Bohun got to know another Ukrainian famous political leader, Yezhny Mirich. And I would not say that they became friends, but they became very well connected. And it was Yezhny Mirich who absolutely influenced on Bohun and moved him from just military leader and in certain way politician into the politician of the European level. And Bohun, together with Nemirich, conducted the negotiations with Swedish king. And Bohun signed the famous agreement, Concourse agreement with Sweden. And in this agreement, the original is in Sweden. As for me, it's very, very important that Swedish part was speaking about Ukraine, about Ukrainian Cossacks as a libera genta, meaning free nation. And this particular document was again signed and probably designed with a participation of Ivan Bohun. So he was turning into the political leader of the European level, which were thinking that the union of Ukraine with Sweden is very important and possible. Before his major idea was the union with Ottoman Empire. He was insistent on this, but unfortunately, regular Cossacks didn't support this idea. And with Moscow state, Bohun has terrible relations. By the way, as I was saying, there are lots of personal stories which we learn now about Ivan Bohun. One of them is his personal relation with Russian political and military leader Sheremetev. And with Sheremetev, Vasily Borisovich Sheremetev, he had terrible relations, and I was able to found in Moscow absolutely very, and I was actually surprised when I was able to find these documents. It's about the only time when Bohun went to Moscow as for negotiations from Verkhovsky. And Sheremetev arranged so that Moscow authorities met Bohun terribly. They treated him like a regular Cossack. And in Moscow bureaucracy, everything was based on how many presents and how many food and drinks are given to the person who is coming to Moscow. So in this level, they treated Bohun as a regular Cossack, almost like a regular Cossack. All this was definitely arranged by Sheremetev, who hated him. And so it was after when he came back to Ukraine, it was Bohun who actually created uprising against Moscow authorities. So, but it's a very interesting personal relations, which makes all story absolutely different. Of course, after many, many years of studying Hetmanate and particularly Bohun, I was always dreaming to know how he looks like. Because according to Polish contemporary tradition, everybody were writing that he was a real Sarmats knight, Sarmatsky lizard. In the tradition of literature tradition, he always was young and attractive. So I was interested in how he actually looked like. He was definitely young, but was he attractive or not? And so I was very, again, lucky to pay attention to the fantastic bas-relief, which was done on the tombstone of King Jan Kazimierz, actually the king who killed Bohun. And on this tomb, there is a bas-relief showing the Battle of Berestechka, where Bohun was a major hero. And so this is his bas-relief. It's in Paris. And I paid attention to the whole structure of this battle, and I made lots of studies on this together with my former student, and we presented our ideas in Warsaw to our colleagues in Polish Institute, and they supported our idea. And so now we can 95% say that this is Ivan Bohun. It's a very romantic style how they presented him, and it's his enemies who made this bas-relief, which makes this even more interesting. And definitely it was contemporaries who knew personally Bohun, and so they presented him as a romantic hero who is trying to save his army. Actually, we know lots of different small things about Bohun, which shows him as a very independent man who could behave himself as he wanted, who wanted to look differently and so on. So, for example, we know that he was called by Tatars the Iron Man. And probably it's because he was always having a cuirass under his robe. And another thing that in this bas-relief, there is a very interesting illustration of his saber, shabla, with a line on it. I still don't know. We discussed it with a major Ukrainian expert in weapons with Stoichkin, and he thinks that it's definitely a line, and it could be both Baroque metaphor saying that he was as he was like a lion, but from another point of view, can also say that he had some special saber, and everybody knew about this in those days. Also, I was able to find that Bohun, after his major victories, probably like in 1655, starts having his personal guards from janissaries. It was like he was showing up like a hetman with his personal guards. And everybody paid attention for this. So it absolutely was not usual and outstanding man, even in those fantastic times of Hetmanate and the president of Bohdan Khmelnytsky. And so that's what I wanted to say today, just very few highlights from the upcoming study. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jana. And I wonder, maybe I suggest the way how we'll organize that. I have a couple of questions, and then maybe you can, again, you can stay there, or maybe sit here, and that will give also time for you to think about your own questions, and I will be watching. I see that already there is one question online from Patrice Dobrovsky, and maybe there will be more. So we will include those questions into discussion as well. So first of all, thank you. Thank you very much for this presentation, and thank you very much for that research, because really we now know much more about that figure in the Hetmanate that really became a legend, but there was very little factual base for our understanding of who he was. And thinking about parallels, I thought when you discussed the situation with Bohun when the Russian authorities demanded him to be executed, I was thinking about Ivan Pitkova, because that's a late 16th century Cossack leader who undertakes attack against Moldova on the territory basically controlled by the Ottoman Empire, and the Ottoman authorities demand him to be executed, and he is executed. So in case of Pitkova got into Moldova, which was certainly the dependency of the Ottomans, and on that basis the claim was made. In case of the Muscovy, You suggested that the battle was taking place between Siversky Donets and Don, and my recollection is that really Bohun, it looks like, got on the territory that was clearly recognized as territory of Muscovy.
Yes, it's mostly, actually this time it was already, you know, the problem was that the border was not agreed in between, clarified between Muscovy and Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. This was one of the reasons why actually he was finally arrested, because after Alexei Mikhailovich became Tsar, started the very new step of negotiations between Muscovy and Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. And in Poland, they decided that it's better to have a treaty with Muscovy and use them to fight against Ottoman Empire instead of using Cossacks to fight against Ottoman Empire. And that because they wanted to please Tsar, they decided to agree to arrest the one who in whom they insisted
on the arrest. Okay.
Yeah. So the actual, you know, there were many events of small conflicts in these wild fields. Mostly they behaved very like allies because of fighting against Tatars. And Bohun, in 41 and 42, he had some contacts with Russian voivode in Valuka and other towns, and he sent those whom he liberated from Tatars, and he even sent some letters to these Russian authorities. So his relations were quite okay because they had the common enemy, which were Tatars. But then something went wrong, and not quite clear why exactly happened this accident, but definitely they were fighting to get control over Don, or in the places where Tatars passed Don on their ways.
And my guess is that was mostly about not just they were fighting for the right to fight with the Tatars, but probably it was a trade route, right? Right.
Yes, of so course, they, yes, they, major they, roads.
They,
yes,
they were trying to control mm-hmm. the trade route.
Yes.
Thank you. Another point that I think it's exceptionally important with Bohun's arrest, you and then he was liberated as result of the Khmelnytsky uprising. You are talking about that, but it shows that Khmelnytsky's story is not so unique, and that brings me to the figure whom you mentioned, and this is of course Koniecpolski, who died in 1646, and it looks like that the entire clientele system, Khmelnytsky, Bohun, and others whom he protected, suddenly starts disintegrating. And the new authorities that come, they bring their own people, and they go after the Koniecpolski people. So the Khmelnytsky uprising, it's very much also about the collapse of one of the clientele systems in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. And again, I think that the Bohun story really, really says that Khmelnytsky in that sense was not unique. And then, of course, Władysław IV dies, right, who was considered to be mm-hmm. a friend and protector of the Cossacks.
And he was.
Right. And so two people who were so essential for this expansion of that area, who had a lot of people who relied on them, suddenly are gone. And that means that there is a major chaos in the borderlands, and the side that lost is now raising the uprising. So I think again that's extremely important. And I will move to basically two questions from my comments part of comments to the question parts of comments. So the first one is, could you tell us more why that person on the image on sarcophagus, why it's Bohun and not some other colonel. It looks like there is a mace. There is a colonel's mace, yes, in the hands of that person. But there was, of course, many regiments and many colonels. And on what basis you make this this suggestion? And the second question is about when and in what way Bohun really makes it into the literary tradition. I'm sorry I didn't mention that among your multiple publications, 140 articles altogether, more than a dozen books. One of them is in English on Ivan Mazepa. We know how Ivan Mazepa became a literary figure through Voltaire and through Byron. What about who was Voltaire and Byron for Bohun? So these are two questions, first about the image and second about who launched his literary career as a literary figure.
I just want to add about the clientele system. I think it's very important. And I think it's very important that after the death of Khmelnytsky, people who came in the region, they had no connections with Cossacks. They didn't understand how important was this difference of this part of, actually was part of Poland, not of Polish, of Litovska Knyazivstva. And they didn't understand that this is a frontier, this is different world, and here it's impossible to behave the same way they behaved in Poland. And so that's created this conflict. Like young Khmelnytsky, Alexander Khmelnytsky, his conflict with Khmelnytsky, and the same happened to Bohun. Regarding Bareliev, in Bareliev, shown three major events of the Battle of Berestechka, the attack of Polish army with Vishnyovetsky as a leader. It's cavalry attack. It also shows how Tatars are leaving the battlefield. And the third is retreat of Cossack army. It shows how the Cossacks are fighting and moving back from the field. And this colonel, he is in charge of these Cossacks who are resisting but going away. And we know from all sources, contemporary sources, that it was Bohun. And all contemporary sources shows only Bohun, who as a person who did this, who was in charge of the Cossacks who were resisting and leaving the battlefield of Berestechka. For example, Pasturi, which was printed in Latin, his story about Berestechka was printed in the same days, and his name's only Bohun, the same as other Polish authors like Kachowski and others.
They refer to him as Teodorovitch or?
No,
or
Bohun.
As Bohun.
Bohun. Already in 51, in Polish sources, he was always Bohun. He called him Teodorovitch only in official documents in 49 when he was. He had to, and this was written by Nell. Everybody already knew that it's Bohun. So Pasturi and what was written in this book and what was written in other books, they all speaks about only Bohun.
And it's Latin language text,
yes.
In Europe. So
yes, yes. And Bareliev was based on the gravura of Hundius. Hondyush, and Hondyush was making also pictures for Book of Pastori, so it's all connected. And Hondyush was taking place during the Battle of Berestechka. He was an official person who was making all these pictures for King. Yeah, so.
Well, it's certainly very, very, very convincing.
Yes. And about Bohun and literature, it's actually first romantic story. Sarmat Litzer started from the times of Vojna Domova, Smole Twardowsko, and from Kachovsky, who was writing as in a very romantic way about him, the most talented, the most successful, and so on, so on. And when Sienkiewicz decided to write his novel Ognime Mechem, he was actually based on Kachovsky and Twardowsky, and he was choosing the key persons. And of course, it was Vishnevsky. And as alter ego, he was trying to pick some most famous Cossack. And the most famous Cossack in the stories of Kachovsky and Twardowsky was Bohun. And so he called him Yurko, but he put his name. And the story is absolutely fantastic. It has nothing to do with the real Bohun, but everybody got to know Bohun from Sienkiewicz. And then Dr. Anthony Rolli wrote a real story about Bohun. And at the same time, probably even in Ukraine, Bohun became very famous because of Kostomarov in Bohdan Khmelnytsky, in which Bohun was one of the top heroes.
Thank you very much. I have, of course, more questions, but it's time to open floor for questions and comments from the audience. And I see already three hands over there, so we'll go from the right, Professor Grabowicz, then gentleman in the middle, and to the left, and then the next question will come from online. So
very simple question. What do we know about Bohun's education? Because this leads to another question of who leaves documents and who leaves versions of what happened. I remember reading and writing on Twardowski's Vojna Domova, and I don't recall Bohun figuring there as being particularly involved with formulating issues, just acting on them. But perhaps you can enlighten me.
Well, definitely he was educated. I mean, we have samples of his handwriting in Ukrainian, and we know there are several sources. We have a copy of his Polish letter, and I found several sources in which was stated that there was a letter from Bohun in Polish. So definitely Polish was very familiar for him, but also he at least could read and understand Latin, because there are two events when he was dealing with the Latin papers. It's a negotiation, it's in Korsun with Swedish ambassador, and it's all papers were in Latin. And another is, it's absolutely different story, and I can speak about this another hour. It's because I'm absolutely sure that Bohun took part in the fight for the fortress Suchava. And in this Suchava event, he also was dealing with Latin sources. So definitely he knew Latin. At least, I don't think he was able to speak Latin like Mazepa, but at least he could read and understand. as a noble, as a representative of Polish-Lithuanian nobility, he definitely had a knowledge, basic knowledge of Latin, which allowed him to understand the documents. And but from small evidences which I was able to collect, we know that he was taking part very actively during discussions of the political future of Ukrainian Hetmanate. He was insisting on his views. He was several times in opposition to Bohdan Khmelnytsky and opposition to his behavior. And so he was definitely insisting in his view. And his view was absolutely independent Ukrainian Hetmanate, with the most, he liked the most idea of the ally with Ottoman Empire.
Very much.
Thank you very much for this lecture. I just have a simple question. When might we expect to see an English translation of your new book?
Well, I'm definitely sure that after publication one book in English, now I know that it's I should write English books absolutely differently. But I hope I will prepare something for English-speaking audience about Bohun, because I think it's very important to understand that Cossacks were not wild military leaders, but they were well-educated politicians who had their own view of future and who were very well introduced into European society.
Thank you very much for a very informative talk. I learned an awful lot. I have a somewhat trivial observation, followed by, I hope, a less trivial question. First of all, I'm constantly impressed by the ability of 19th century romantic artists to make all their subjects look far more handsome than they were in reality. To me, they all look like the English king, Richard the Lionheart. Where's Ilya, a realist like Ilya Repin, when we need him? The question is about military leadership, and you clearly indicated that he was a skilled and feared leader in land warfare, of armies of landlubbers, as the sailors might say. But do your sources give much indication that he might be equally proficient in naval warfare, or did the fleets of Chaikas belong to an earlier age? Thank you.
Thank you. In 1641-42, he was using some boards in his raids to wild fields. It was not Chaika, but it was some kind of boards. Definitely, so this was used and very efficiently. In certain sense, like battle at Batoh shows that probably he read about some antique story about antique battles, because many military experts compare Batoh with some antique events. And so probably when he was getting his education, he was able to read, I don't know, maybe in Latin, some of the antique histories, and had some ideas about how to act, how military leaders should act. But definitely then he got very good experience in the wild field. And then in 1649, it was a year when he was trying his tricks, because he's well known for tricks. He never acted like directly. He always using different ways, every time something different, which makes his enemies frustrated. And so this was absolutely talent. It was definitely huge talent, but also he was working every time, and he was preparing every battle. He was studying the field, he was studying the fortresses, he was studying where the best way to arrange this battle, how to do. And so he was, he had absolutely unbelievable energy. He, I noticed, like, he would come on to a huge battle, and then in just few days after, he would leave into the huge campaign and then again do something different. So he was very, very active, full of energy up to the end of his life. And so this combination of education, talent, willingness to work on himself, to improve himself and his skills, made him so so unbelievable.
Thank you very much. And we have, I'll read two questions we have online. One is, as I already mentioned, from Patrice Dobrowski, and the question is, who do you think the Polish king proposed, why do you think the Polish king proposed that Bohun become hetman? Did he not know of the death sentence? And another question from Jerry Bohun. So I don't know, related to Bohun of our today's talk or not. And the question is, thank you very much for very interesting presentation. Would there be a Polish version of the book too?
Yeah, there is already negotiations about Polish version, so I hope that there will be definitely a Polish version. And why Polish king proposed Bohun to become hetman? Because he definitely knew that he was best among colonels of Khmelnytsky, and Bohun definitely had the chance to remove Cossacks from, to move Cossacks from Khmelnytsky to himself, to become actually a hetman, because if they gave the mace to Zalusky in 1649, it was useless. He couldn't do anything. But Bohun was so famous and so loved by and supported by Cossacks that he definitely could make a real position and could influence on the Cossacks to attract them to himself. So about the death sentence, definitely I think they knew, but they gave him a letter in which they said that they will forget everything what has happened before. So it was a...
Thank you very much. Yeah, Michelle, please.
Thank you very much for everything and for being here too. My question about Bohun, it's very curious to me because he has these elements. I wonder what his awareness, how much you can derive from the documents that you've seen about his sense of himself as in history as a Cossack. Like, what is a Cossack? Is a service nobility only, you know, someone who's very skilled and as proud of his military skills and prowess and leadership skills, is still perhaps not necessarily totally secure in nobility. And so I sort of wonder whether you get any sense of where he places himself and Cossack nobility from what you've seen. You know, do we get anything from this? I'm thinking about the generation before, where Konashevich, you know, is mythologized. There's an attempt to connect him to the past, of course. And I wonder if you get any sense from Bohun about how he feels about his historical place and the reflection of who he was on Cossacks and Cossack leadership.
Yes, I think, first of all, thank you very much for the question, because I think it's very important. It's not only about Bohun, but Khmelnytsky himself, how they represented themselves, the Cossacks, the nobility. Definitely Bohun behaved as a nobleman. He felt that he's equal to anybody with he was dealing with. So it doesn't matter if it's magnates or Moscow boyars, and that was the reason why he got such a conflict with Sheremetev, because Sheremetev couldn't accept that. And when Bohun was dealing first with Buturlin liked this, and actually they had good relations. Bohun was writing to Buturlin in the way like Polish nobility wrote each other, Milosliwy Panie Brate, etc. So he was very independent, and and for him, nobility it makes him equal to any noble person in Poland or Moscow, all over the world. But Cossack, it's the way it's a military person who is absolutely free. And so this is a fantastic combination of being free as a Cossack and being absolutely feeling that his position is very high as a nobleman. And Bohun was really behaving like Polish Sarmat, and in many cases, and I found like evidence that during negotiations with his enemy, it's Vinnytsia, Bohun invited the Polish nobility with whom he had negotiations for the dinner. It's like a very Sarmatsky way of behavior. So you can fight with this enemy in the morning, and then you have a dinner with him, and then you will fight again in the evening. So this is the way like real knights behave. And so that's why Polish nobility was so much impressed by Bohun, because they saw in him an equal person, equal enemy. And that's why Kachowski and Twardowski are writing about him in such manner, because it was, as Twardowski was writing, that it was he was a man who of Mars. And so for them, it was very, they were excited by possibility to fight with such enemy. Thank you.
Thank you. I wanted to ask about his relationship with the Ottomans and how he saw them, and whether any of those relations entailed, like possibly like from a later period, and I'm not a historian, but the taking of captives or allowing them to take captives. Because from my understanding, perhaps from literature, but that caused problems later on, you know, between upper and lower classes, perhaps. But in any case, is there any record of allowing the Tatars, for example, to take captives?
When he was in his youth, he was dealing in the wild fields. When he was fighting with Tatars, and found some captures which were prevented by Tatars, he always liberated them and let them go without any payment. in this way, we actually don't have any evidences of another times when he had any captures The only is event during Batoh, but it was happening already not by Bohun, but by other Cossack leaders, and Bohun didn't took part in the execution of the captured Poles. So he was always trying to behave very in the way of how he this thought is the way to be a knight, to be Litzer, and to how to behave properly even during the war. So there is no evidence of him being cruel. Of course, it was war, but in compared to even for to another Cossack leaders, he never he could kill a Cossack for not following the orders. Just they can kill, but the same as Serhii Dachny, because for here Serhii Dachny and for Bohun, army should be very much how to say the behavior should be there should be an order, and anybody who is out of order, he should be executed. And so for him, it was very important.
We have additional questions online, and I guess that time-wise, probably that's where we'll wrap up our today's meeting. So I see that Megan already answered a question from Danielle Bohun. The question was about the recording, and yes, they will be recording on YouTube channel. And then question from Alexandra Haidai. She writes, "Hi, great talk. How did you get interested in Bohun in the first place? How is he different from others?" And another question from Camila Bohun-Borowski. This is really great and very informative presentation, especially the part about his education. Do you know if he had any children?
I was first interested by Bohun when I, in my youth, read Mykola Kostomarov, Bohdan Khmelnytsky, and the style of his book is very, very exciting. And there were several parts devoted to Bohun, and they were very interesting. And so this was the beginning how I was got interested in Bohun and decided to make some studies about him. And the second question was...
The question is about whether he had any children.
Yeah, he definitely had...
About his death, if you
can. Yeah, definitely he had a brother, Vasil Bohun, and his brother also had children. And Ivan Bohun at least had two sons. We don't know what has happened to them. But definitely he had. And about his death, I already made some studies before, many years ago, on how exactly what has happened, how exactly he died. But in my book, I'm bringing some new highlights in this. He was killed by Poles, and he was killed probably during the military meeting of the, including the king. And they were trying to arrest him, and he resisted, and he was killed. And they throw the body to the river because they wanted to get rid of this, and because they were very much afraid that a small group of Cossacks, which were together with Polish king, will resist. And so it was a huge secret, and they were trying to keep the secret for a few, even weeks. They were saying that he got sick, and then they said that he died, and the Cossacks were very, very much upset. And a few weeks later, they started a huge uprising at the right bank, and actually Poland lost their control of the right bank. It was a revenge.
That takes care of the questions that we got online. So maybe one last question, if there is someone in the audience who has the question but is afraid to ask. nothing like that. Okay, well, if not, then let me thank Tatiana Tairova-Yakovleva on behalf of all of us for this presentation, for the academic research, really very, very new and very original on Ukrainian history, and for the position that you have been taking as a scholar, as a person, in the context of this war, and we know how high the price for that. So thanks again for your contribution to the field of Ukrainian studies in more than one way.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, sorry. You're not allowed to leave. I have something to announce. Okay. So first of all, for those who came to this seminar on the way to Philadelphia, going to ACES, Association for the Slavic and East European Studies, so please come and visit booths 309 and 311. That's where the our institute will be relocated for the period between November 30th and December 3rd. And in terms of our programming here, the next event will be taking place on Wednesday, December the 6th at 5 p.m. It will be seminar in Ukrainian studies, and it will be a book talk with Serhii Belenki, the director of our summer program. The title of the talk is Laboratory of Modernity, a column Ukraine Between Empire and Nation, 1772-1914. It is also the title of his book. So thanks again, and I look forward to seeing you, if not in Philadelphia, then certainly here on December the 6th.